Good morning, Bridgeway. How is everybody this morning? So good to see you guys. If you're joining us online, welcome to our worship this morning. We're going to start as we normally do with singing to praises to our risen King. Would you stand with me?
Band, Well, good morning. Good to see everybody. Welcome to Bridgeway. Am I on back there again? There we go. All right. If you're new, there's a QR code in front of you. If you wouldn't mind to scan that and tell us a little bit about yourself. If you don't like technology, we've got paper too. Bulletins, you can fill out that communication card, drop it in an offering box. There's one in the back. And then for each guest card or digital guest card we get, we'll donate $10 on your behalf to A Child's Hope. And that $10 feeds a child for a month. So if you wouldn't mind to fill that information out, that would be awesome. Diaper drive for the Owens family ends next week. So if you forgot your diapers today, bring them next Sunday. Just a reminder for that. We're changing the name of Adopt-A-Senior. And the reason being, and if you're not familiar with what this program is, Sunrise Manor is kind of like an extension of our church, and we have church services there every Sunday, and we encourage our folks to adopt a resident, essentially, to send them a birthday card or go visit them, because many people in a nursing home don't get visitors. Either they don't have family left, or their family just doesn't visit them, and so we are encouraging our folks to adopt. I don't want to call it adopt a senior anymore, because not all of the residents are seniors. Some are in their 40s, some are in their 50s, and just because of different situations in their life, this is where they find themselves. And so we're calling it adopt a friend, and if you would like to participate, sign up. The QR code, Brandon, is that probably the best way to do that? And we'll line you up, and then you can go meet them, and yeah, it's a good time. High school food pack. So our men's group, we just did a food pack last Wednesday. It went really well. And so high school, we're up this Wednesday. Okay. And then the very next Wednesday, middle school is going to be up doing a food pack. This is for Empower Youth. It's a local organization that helps impoverished kids in our area. So it's always good to keep our students serving. Ladies Bible study this week. And then next Sunday evening, I want to encourage all of you to come. It's going to be like our family anniversary party. So Bridgeway turns 10 this year. We're going to have a big what to do in June, but this one's just kind of like that little family birthday party you do with your mom and dad and a cake, right? This is kind of what we're doing. It's not something we're like publicizing to, you know, public people in the public can come, you know what I mean? But we're not doing like, yeah, you can't come. This is for family only. I say all that to say next Sunday night, we're going to have some cake. I encourage you to bring a dessert of your liking. We've got a slideshow of the past 10 years. We'll listen to some testimonies, and it'll be just a good time. Okay, that's next Sunday. And let me encourage you to come out to that. Oh, there's choir practice that night as well. Church work day, we want to get the outside cleaned up before Easter. And so if winter ever goes away, the grass will start growing and it would be warm enough to go outside and do some stuff. So Saturday, April 1st. Also, I know I'm throwing a lot at you. It's all in your bulletin, but none of you read it. So I have to say it up here. you ever seen that t-shirt that says, it's in the bulletin, been there for weeks? I need to get that. Our Easter egg hunt this year is, I want all of our parents with children to go to the Sunrise Manor Easter egg hunt. That's your contribution, to show up, bring your children so the residents there can watch them have an Easter egg hunt. Sunrise Manor is, you know, doing all the eggs and all of that. Our job is to show up, and it does wonders for those residents to see kids just be kids. So let me encourage you to mark that down. That's also April 1st. Baptism class, we're going to have a baptism on Easter, so you can sign up for that. And we got a few folks interested in getting baptized on Easter, and so come to that class. And then, all right, so we're changing the title of this all-nighter to not an all-nighter. I'm calling it a midnighter. And the reason, all right, how many of you have ever worked in student ministry and have done an all-nighter? Anybody in here? Yeah, most of you have not. Shame on you. It's a long night, right? And usually by 1 a.m., everybody's done, including the students. So I was talking with the other pastors, and to better help, you know, get chaperones to volunteer, we're going to end at midnight. We're going to start at 7 instead of 9. So we got 5 solid hours to do all sorts of stuff. But that's old information, but I want to let everybody know we're still having that event. It just starts at 7 and ends at midnight. And so that's that. Okay, if you need prayer, you can also let us know that. We'll pray over those and get in touch with you. But let's bow together this morning. Again, I thank you for being with us today. And just take a moment to talk to the Lord. It's a good moment to pause, maybe to reflect on this past week, or maybe to bring something before him that's been heavy on your heart. Just pause and do that at this moment. Almighty God, we come to you today. God, grateful for the opportunity to gather with our faith family. God, we're here to worship you, to reflect on your word. I know you've got some stuff for us today out of the book of Ecclesiastes. I'm excited to see what you're going to do with that today. God, we thank you for the new faces we see today as well. We hope they feel welcome and loved. God, we pray for those who are on this spiritual journey of life, and you know they're trying to figure some things out, still got questions, and we pray for them, God. Lift them up to you, as it's definitely a challenge in some cases for folks. And so we think of their questions and concerns today. We pray for those who are far from you to draw close, Lord. Thank you for the salvation that you give us. We're grateful for it, Lord. We love you. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Let's stand together. We'll sing a few more songs this morning.
Mercy never fails.
going to sing an old hymn together. It's one of those really simple hymns that repeats quite a bit. But the words are so profound and so targeted. And it's one of those songs that's almost tough to sing, because you really have to mean it to sing this song. It's called Where He Leads Me.
Amen. That was beautiful. All right. Well, we are back in the book of Ecclesiastes, starting chapter number 7. And it's not going to be as depressing from here on out. I mean, there'll be a few parts that might seem that way, but it's kind of a turning point in this book where Solomon has been basically giving us insight into his experiment of trying to find meaning in this life apart from God, and he has failed in every aspect of life. He tries to find it in pleasure, He tries to find it in money. He tries to find it in power. He tries to find it in work. He tries every single way he can, and his conclusion is the same. It's futile. It's empty at the end of the day. Him trying to find meaning apart from God, he says, is like trying to grab smoke. It just goes right through your fingers. And so in this next section, we're going to get to some Proverbs of Solomon, which he's pretty famous for doing those kinds of things. And let us in on a couple things. And the theme in different parts of his book has been that ignorance is bliss. And I'd say to a certain degree that's true, right? I mean, for children, they're ignorant of a lot of things. I don't mean that in a talking down to them kind of way, but there are things that, you know, children don't need to understand at a certain stage in their life, right? Like we protect that innocence because they only have it for so long. And so there are things they are ignorant of that they will learn about later on in life, but we want to protect that. And Solomon had a similar conclusion in chapter 1 when he said, "For with much wisdom is much sorrow. As knowledge increases, grief increases." And he says, you know, the more I know, the more of a burden it becomes. And things he knew about the world and how the world operated, it just kind of really bummed him out. But what's going to happen in these next two chapters is he's going to take a second look at wisdom, and he's going to modify his view about it a little bit. He's going to find some good things about wisdom and things that can be applied in a healthy way. In fact, he mentions wisdom 14 times in the next two chapters. So he asks a question at the end of chapter 6. He says, "For who knows what is good for anyone in life, in the few days of his futile life that he spends like a shadow? Who can tell anyone what will happen after him under the sun?" And so he's going to answer these questions in chapter 7. But before we get there, and we're gonna talk about today six contributions that wisdom has for us. But before we do that, I want to ask you some questions. And these are true or false questions, all right? And let's just see how you do, all right? True or false? Let's bring up the first one, please. I like laughter better than crying. So just answer that in your mind if that's true or false for you. Next, please. I like weddings better than funerals. We're not even going to expand upon that one much, I guess. Number 3, I like thinking of my birthday better than my death day. True or false? Number 4, I like compliments better than criticisms. Is that true or false? I like shortcuts better than the long way. Now, what's weird about Solomon is, as we're going to see, if you said false to all of those, he's like, you're pretty wise. So wait a minute. For him, crying's better than laughter. For him, funerals are better than weddings. The day of your death is better than your birthday. Criticisms are better than compliments. And going the long way is better than shortcuts. Isn't that kind of weird? That's what we're going to unpack this morning. So we're going to be in chapter 7. And one word you're going to see over and over again, at least in the first 8 verses, is the word better. He's going to show you a better way of operating in this life. Because again, the question was, who knows what is good for anyone in life? And so he's going to answer some of those questions. He wants to show us a better way. And the first 4 verses, Solomon is telling us there's a lot to be gained by some sober reflection on life. So let's take a look here. Chapter 7, verse 1, and the first conclusion we have or point I'd like to make concerning wisdom is wisdom causes us to look ahead. He says, a good name is better than fine perfume. A good name is better than fine perfume. Perfume is there for a little bit, but then it goes away. He's talking about something that's going to last longer. He says, it's your name. Now, this is different, but have you ever looked up what your name means, your first and last name? I can remember looking up the name Cunningham because it's Scottish or Irish, depending on the internet, I guess. I don't know. But there's that part of me is like, yeah, I'm probably going to be like a warrior or something, you know? Like, warrior from the east. It means rabbit farmer. And then I look up my name, Brent, right? My given name, that's got to mean something significant. It means from the hill. So I'm a rabbit farmer from the hill, I guess. I don't know if you looked up your last name, first name, but obviously what Solomon's talking about isn't necessarily the meaning of our name, but the reputation or the testimony that we have. And as Christians, this is important because we represent Jesus Christ. In fact, Matthew chapter 5, take a look. If we can bring that up. Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth, but if salt should lose its taste, how can it be made salty? It is no longer good for anything but to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet." Verse 14. "You are the light of the world. A city situated on a hill cannot be hidden." Verse 15. Just keep going after I read there, Rebecca. "No one lights a lamp and puts it under a basket, but rather lights on a lampstand and gives light for all who are in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." Like, as a Christian, I'm not saved because I do good works. I do good works because I'm saved and I want to live a pleasing life to my Lord. My testimony is something that has influence. And Christian, your testimony, whether you know it or not, has influence one way or another. And Solomon's point here in looking ahead is, hey, your reputation is valuable. Your legacy is valuable. And you need to look ahead and think about what's before you. Because one day, you're going to have a legacy. All of us will of some type. In Proverbs 10, it says, "The remembrance of the righteous is a blessing, but the name of the wicked will rot." And I think about that, you know, like, decades in the future, centuries in the future, you know, will I have left a meaningful legacy for the Lord? And as Christians, our testimony can be influential in the positive and in the negative. I bring him up from time to time simply because this was such a gut punch for me, at least, when... If you're not familiar with Ravi Zacharias, he was the leader of Ravi Zacharias International Ministries, the largest, most influential apologetics organization on the planet. Had branches in other countries and incredibly influential. And I can remember going to his conference. I had kind of given up on going to conferences just because all they want to do is like sell you stuff, even preacher conferences. I know. And I'm like, I don't want to go anymore. I got better things to do. But this conference was very intimate. There's about as many seats at this conference. The seats in this room were about as many as there were. And that's how close you were to the speakers. It's very intimate. I'm like, man, this is awesome. And it was so amazing because what you got there was just good stuff. Speakers from Nigeria, Francis Chan was there. I got to hear him, and it was really, really cool. And I thought, man, I just want to shake Ravi's hand and just say thank you. I don't want an autograph because that would be weird, right? Can I have your autograph? I'm a grown man, you know? Sign my book. But he got off the elevator, and that's what I did. I shook his hand, and I said, man, thank you for your work. It's had an influence on my life. And then he passes away, and behind the scenes, what we didn't know was there was a lot of hush money, keeping people quiet about things he was doing that were immoral. And some were like, well, you're just talking bad about a guy after he dies. No, this stuff was going on while he was living, and it was starting to come to fruition, and he just happened to die in the midst of all that. And I was like a gut punch, right? You know, because it's kind of your hero, one of the heroes of the faith. And so not long after that, I opened one of his books, just for some reflection, I guess, because I have a hard time reading them anymore. And I read this. This is him writing about his ministry. I had proposed, talking about the inception of RZIM, I had proposed a different name for the ministry other than my own name. But after everyone pondered it overnight, they advised, "No, Ravi, so much has happened with people in ministry having gone astray. If you give this ministry your name, it will stand up behind your integrity or fall with the lack of it." It was a scary thought to me, my character behind an entire organization, yet I knew it was only right. RZIM is no more to this very day. It's building a shell. And you think about a legacy, right? The remembrance of the righteous is a blessing, but the name of the wicked will rot. If he had paused and looked ahead and thought, what am I doing? Or if he had allowed accountability in his life. And we're going to see that a little bit where criticism is better than compliments, because sometimes we need criticized. Sometimes you need someone in your life to say, stop what you're doing. A good name is to be chosen over great wealth. Favor is better than silver and gold. And there's a lot more talking about a good name, but I think you get the idea. There's a reputation. So think about, if you could stop and pause in your mind at this very moment about your own legacy. You'll have one. Can you look ahead to what you think that's going to look like? Wisdom looks to the future by reflecting on the past. Take a look here, chapter 7, verse 1. A good name is better than fine perfume, and the day of one's death is better than the day of one's birth. It is better to go to a house of mourning than to a house of feasting, since that is the end of all mankind, and the living should take it to heart. He says there's two days where your name is prominent, the day that you get your name and the day that it shows up in an obituary. Now, if you're thinking, well, geez, Brent, so Solomon just, is this guy just down all the time? Like, does he want us just to despair of life itself? No. There's eight times in this book where he tells us to enjoy life, enjoy the blessings of God, but it's got to be done with the right perspective. And Ecclesiastes does not. Listen, it brings up death all the time. I mentioned it's that needle that pops the bubble. Whatever bubble you got, boom, Solomon pops it. Because we should be thinking accurately about this life. And so he's wanting them to know, like, listen, you reflect more on your life at a funeral than you ever do at a party. Not that parties are bad, like feasting. I like to feast, but I don't have somber reflection of my life when I'm feasting. There's a reality of mortality that sets in when we're faced with death. I mean, whenever I preach a funeral, I mention that phrase right there. You are now looking and dealing with the reality of your own mortality. One day you will be in this casket. And that's not morbid, that's realistic. And I want people to think realistically when we're at a funeral. Now, if their loved one is with the Lord, man, it's a celebration. We mourn, but we don't mourn like those who have no hope. But I want them to know, this is serious business. You have so many things in your life to distract you about, away from thinking about this day, but here it is right in front of you. You can't avoid it. So we have the day we're born and the day we die. And everything in between is marked by a dash, right? If you bring that up. This is not anyone's particular birth year or death, okay? I just asked Brandon for random numbers. And if you're related to someone and that's it, I apologize ahead of time. Take it out on Pastor Brandon. But seriously, Our life is marked by just that little dash in between, right? We've got this vapor of a life to do anything for the glory of God, to invest anything in eternity. That's what we're given. That's what we've got. I was in no control over the first year, and I'm no control over the last. Psalm 90, teach us to number our days carefully so that we may develop wisdom in our hearts. I mean, if you only had 30 days left to live, then that number is going to be pretty important. Yet I don't know how long I have. By God's grace, hopefully it'll be a while. But the psalmist is like, number your day. This day is important. March 19th is an important day for you. You know why? Because you're alive. And God gave you March 19th. It is March 19th, right? Or else that would have just totally... Is it March 19th? Okay. Psalm 39, some of my favorite verses because it challenges me to think soberly about life. Lord, make me aware of my end and the number of my days so that I will know how short-lived I am. In fact, you have made my days just inches long. My lifespan is as nothing to you. Yes, every human being stands as only a vapor. Selah. Which Selah is that pause. You stop and you reflect about what you just read in those two verses. Make me aware of my end. Why? Because then I can think accurately about how I should live now. When we did our little tour of New England a few years ago, we went camping all throughout New England. Most of the churches out there, not all of them, but many of the older churches out there all have a graveyard outside of them. And in fact, the chapel where Bridgeway started, right across from Walmart, there's a graveyard there. And that church has been there since 1855. Before that, it was a wooden structure. There's a Revolutionary War veteran buried in that cemetery, which I think is just fascinating. But you ever wonder why churches had graveyards in their yard? I mean, we've got a yard. We're not going to bury anybody in it. It'd be kind of weird, we would think. But back then, there were several different reasons. One of them was if you couldn't afford to be buried in a family cemetery or some kind of thing or whatever, the churchyard is where you could get buried. But also, and the logic apparently from some of these churches was they wanted people, the people of God, as they gathered each Sunday, to also be remember that they're only here for a short period of time and that you've got to do something with the gospel. You've got to share the truth of the message of the gospel with other people because this is man's end. So it was like this constant reminder for them. Funerals remind us how short life is. Parties don't really do that. I mean, think about reading your own obituary. What would that look like? What would be said about you? The guy who came up with the Nobel Peace Prize, Alfred Nobel, that's exactly what happened to him. His brother died, and when he read the obituary, the person who wrote the obituary thought he had died. And so he's reading his own obituary, and it says this: the merchant of death is dead. Why'd they call him that? Because he invented dynamite. The merchant of death is dead. Dr. Alfred Nobel, who became rich by finding ways to kill more people faster than ever before, died yesterday. That's brutal, isn't it? And he's reading that about himself. Now, if you do any reading on Nobel, he thought his discovery, his invention of dynamite would actually stop war from happening because he thought once mankind sees how devastating this is, they won't want to go to war anymore. Naive, you could say, but his heart was, I guess, in the right place. So upon reading that, he had some serious reflection of his life. He's like, do I want to be remembered for this? And so we got some input from some friends. He came up with a trust and developed prizes for those who would help further world peace and humanitarian causes, hence the Nobel Peace Prize, which is what he's known for. So when he says the day of your death is better than the day of your birth, it causes you to reflect. And as a Christian, I mean, the day of my death isn't the day that Brent Cunningham ceases to exist. My relationship with Christ extends from this life into the next one. But here's the flip side of that. If you're not a follower of Christ, you don't cease to exist. You exist without God. The Bible calls that hell. If you don't want God in this life, you do not get him in the next. Chapter 7, verse 3. Grief is better than laughter, for when a face is sad, a heart may be glad. The heart of the wise is in a house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in a house of pleasure. And I've seen that, where someone's face is sad, but their heart not so much. When a loved one who dies in the Lord, there is mourning, no doubt. But there is a peace that exists there because I know where that person is. I know that they are more alive than I am at that point. And so, yeah, there's sorrow, but it's not a sorrow without hope. So this makes us think about life, and I hope it's making you think about your life. So he wants us to look ahead, but he also wants us to reflect. Okay, think about your legacy. Think about what comes next. Then verse 5, it is better to listen to rebuke from a wise person than to listen to the song of fools. He's telling us to be teachable. For like a crackling of burning thorns under the pot, so is the laughter of the fool. This too is also futile. Have you ever burned a bunch of like sticker bushes? They don't burn very long. They burn very quickly and it crackles. It makes a bunch of noise. And that's kind of the point he's making. Like, you might be getting plenty of compliments from these foolish folks, but it doesn't mean anything. It's better to listen to a rebuke from a wise person. Meaning there are people that need to be in your life who can call you out. And you need to give them the permission to do so. To speak into your life. That takes humility. Listen, I don't like being criticized. But I also know that I have blind spots, and so do you. And hopefully you have people in your life who can point out your blind spots, and then it's up to you how you're going to respond. Are you going to be ticked off at them, or are you going to be grateful that they care enough about you to tell you the truth? Because Ravi Zacharias didn't have it. He didn't allow for accountability in his life. And it led him to go and do things that you would think he would have never done. And that can be you. And it can be me. There, but by the grace of God, there goes I. That's why I encourage you to get plugged into some type of smaller group here to get to know people who come to the same church that you go to. It's hard to get to know people in this setting. Because what's going to happen, we're going to finish the sermon in about, I don't know, whenever we get finished, and we're gonna sing a song. I made some of you nervous there. And then we're gonna disperse. Get into some type of a small group. Men, let me encourage you, come to our men's group. You want a group of brothers who are there to, yes, maybe call you out, but also support you, come to men's group. It's there, it's real, it's legit. And you can ask any of the men that go, that's the reality of it. Ladies group, I don't go to that one. Ask one of the ladies that do. But get plugged in some way. We'll have some groups after service as well. So be teachable. Proverbs 15, a fool despises his father's discipline, but a person who accepts correction is sensible. Verse 31, one who listens to life-giving rebukes will be at home among the wise. I'm not always right. I'm not perfect. And sometimes I need called out. And even as your pastor, my ears are open. I've had folks who come to Bridgeway, come and lovingly confront me about something I've said. And I was in the wrong. And I was grateful for it. I got blinders, so do you. Allow people to speak into your life. There's a ton more Proverbs on this, but be teachable. Let's keep going. Chapter 7, verse 7, and he's going to tell us, hey, don't take the shortcuts here. Be patient. Surely the practice of extortion turns a wise person into a fool, and a bribe corrupts the mind. The end of a matter is better than its beginning. A patient spirit is better than a proud spirit. Don't let your spirit rush to be angry, for anger abides in the hearts of fools. He wants us to not take the shortcut. Don't bribe. He doesn't want us to get angry quickly. He wants us to be patient and wait on the Lord. Proverbs 14, a quick-tempered person acts foolishly, and one who schemes is hated. One pastor said, second only to suffering, waiting may be the greatest teacher and trainer in godliness, maturity, and genuine spirituality most of us will ever encounter. Suffering is a terrific teacher, though we don't like it. Patience is a terrific teacher, though we don't like it. And we can learn from these situations. And God might have you in the waiting room right now, and you're not sure why he has you there, but it might be because he's developing something in you. That very well might be the possibility. And as a Christian, we know, Romans 8, that all things work together for good to those who love God or are called according to his purpose. I know God can use the suffering I endure. I know he can use that time of patience that I've got to go through. And I trust him with that. Verse 10, don't say, where were the former days? Or why were the former days better than these, since it is not wise of you to ask this? He's saying, hey, don't long for the good old days. I know the world's a bit crazy. The world's always been crazy, though. He said, well, Brent, back in the day, we didn't have this issue. Maybe you didn't, but you had some issues. There were problems there. It's been said the good old days are a combination of a bad memory and a good imagination. We look at it through rose-colored glasses. Furthermore, when we just talk about the good old days, we forget that we're in the present, okay? Whatever the good old days were, they're not coming back. And I try to look at it through the lens of our children. Instead of griping about the good old days and how things, let's try to the best of our ability to make a good world for them. Instead of complaining about how good the old one was. The old one's not coming back. It's gone. And the world is crazy. And yeah, there's some crazier things, I guess you could say, to some degree, that are trying to influence our children than before. And that's why we need to determine to make a better world for our children now. Instead of just, well, back in the day, it wasn't like that. Congratulations, but we're not back in the day. And Solomon says it's not wise to think like that. Think about how you can serve now. How you can make an impact now instead of longing for what was. Yesterday's gone. Verse 11 tells us to value wisdom. Wisdom is as good as an inheritance and an advantage to those who see the sun, because wisdom is protection as silver is protection. But the advantage of knowledge is that wisdom preserves the life of its owner. There's value in wisdom. Don't deny it. Don't disregard it. Verse 13, consider the work of God, for who can straighten out what he has made crooked? And in this verse, he's just telling you to trust God. If you're going to underline anything, underline the word consider, which means sit and ponder. There are plenty of things that go through my mind that I think, God, what are you doing? I do not understand fill in the blank. Now, I'm not going to argue with God, but I am going to ask why. We talked about that last week. So many psalms start with the word, how long, or words, how long, or the word, why. Where are you at? Where are you, God? In some of these instances, you see that with David especially. And that's how my prayers are sometimes. Like, Lord, this, I don't get this. This is weird. Help me understand this. There are some things he has made crooked. He could straighten out if he so chooses. I don't always know why God does the things that he does. Unless it's revealed in Scripture, I can't always give you a why. Well, Brent, why did God do it this way? I don't know. If his word doesn't tell me, I cannot obtain the mind of God, because I'm a finite creature. I don't know. Now, if his word reveals it to us, then we can talk about it. But there's that flip side. Do I actually think I would be able to comprehend everything that God does? If I could, I would be God. Right? If I knew everything like God does, that then I would be his equal, but I'm not. There's a gap there. So what do I do in this gap of understanding? Well, Solomon wants us to trust God. And I know one day when I see God face to face, I'm going to have those questions answered. In the meantime, I'm going to trust him with those things. The Serenity Prayer, part of the Serenity Prayer says, and I'm not saying I agree with all the theology of it, but one part of it, oh God, give us serenity to accept what cannot be changed, courage to change what should be changed, and wisdom to distinguish one from the other. And so I'm going to trust God. There's going to be some things that seem crooked to me. Maybe God made them that way. I'm going to trust him. Verse 14. In the day of prosperity, be joyful, but in the day of adversity, consider. That's that word again. Underline it. God has made the one as well as the other so that no one can discover anything that will come after him. And he's reinforcing, there are things that are beyond you and they will always be beyond you. In chapter 3, he says, God put eternity in our hearts, yet we can't understand eternity. Like, we have this longing to worship, and people fill that with all sorts of stuff that's in us. Because God created us to worship. He created us for eternity, though I don't completely grasp all of that. And that's all right. God is God, and I am not. So the question that Solomon's answering in this chapter, for who knows what is good for anyone in this life? Well, it's good to look ahead and reflect. The day of your death is better than the day of your birth. We're told it's good to be teachable. There's wisdom there. Take rebukes from people who love you. Don't take wrong shortcuts. Be patient. There's value in patience. There's things God can cultivate in you in patient times. Don't long for the good old days because they're not coming back. Serve Christ in the present. We're told to value wisdom and to trust God. Those are the six things that he teaches us in these first 14 verses. We've got a lot more to get to. We won't get to today, but I hope God has given you something to take away this morning. Let's bow together to pray. I want to thank you for your time. For the Christian, I want you to just be praying about maybe something God pricked your heart about, looking ahead and reflecting what your legacy will be. Maybe there's someone you need to give constructive criticism to. Not only should we be teachable, but we should be willing to teach. Well, man, it's none of my business. It is. If God has challenged your heart about that, there's conviction about that. You say, I love this person. What they're doing is wrong. It could potentially send them down a wrong way. You should say something. If you're here today, you're not a follower of Christ. Again, thank you so much for being here, and we're grateful for the journey that you're on, that you're taking steps, and we would love to help you with that journey. And so if you're watching online right now and you're not a follower of Christ, but you would like to know more about that, just put a question mark in the comment section. If you're in this room, let me encourage you, you can do a couple things. After we're done here, you could scan the QR code for the first time guests and just mark that you want more information on becoming a Christian. Or you could pull me aside, pull Pastor Brandon aside and just say, hey, I'd like to talk sometime. I know that takes courage, but this needs to be the most important issue of your life because it has eternal ramifications. And we'd love to talk to you about that. Almighty God, I thank you for this text this morning where we're reminded to think about our death, not in a morbid way, but in a way of reflecting and thinking about what we're going to leave behind. what testimony, what reputation. One, Lord, I hope it's one that glorifies you, that has a positive influence for the cause of Christ, and not one that would bring some shame. We're all challenged with that today, to think about that. God, there are those thinking about death and it scares them because they're not sure what comes next. I'm thinking of that person right now. And Lord, we pray that they would make this the most important issue of their life. We'd love to talk to them. I pray they wouldn't just leave it at a thought, but they'd leave it at something that they pursue and seek answers for. God, I thank you for the people in my life who've given constructive criticisms, rebuke. It's helpful. Lord, we all have blind spots, and we need fellow brothers and sisters in Christ to help us. And so I pray, God, that as a church, that we'd be willing to continue to do that in a loving way. Again, thank you so much for this text, this word today. I know it's challenged and convicted me, as I'm sure it has many others. We love you. We pray in the mighty name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen. Let's stand. We'll sing a few songs before we're dismissed.
Church. Have a great week.